Silvopasture and Maribi. Welcome to Sustainability Nuggets. Today, I will be discussing the contribution of the agricultural sector to climate change and global warming, and I will be highlighting ways that certain processes can be improved within the sector in order to reduce its carbon footprint. According to a chart released by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in the year 2010, the forestry and agricultural sector is seen to contribute about 24% of the global greenhouse gas emission, making this sector the second largest contributor to global warming after heat and electricity production using fossil fuel. In this sector, greenhouse gases are emitted during deforestation, land clearing for farm creation, soil degradation, agricultural activities such as waste management, biomass burning, and fertilizer use. Let's look at agriculture alone. Agriculture involves the cultivation of crops and the rearing of livestock. Agriculture is meant to be both a source and a sink for greenhouse gases. A source meaning a net contributor of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, while a sink meaning a net withdrawer of greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. When the source capabilities of a farm exceeds its sink capability significantly, a problem arises as excess greenhouse gases is released into the atmosphere, leading to global warming. The primary greenhouse gases related to agriculture are methane, nitrous oxide, and carbon dioxide. The global warming potential of every greenhouse gas is measured in terms of carbon dioxide, because carbon dioxide is the largest occurring greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. The global warming potential is the relative measure of how much heat a greenhouse gas traps in the atmosphere. The global warming potential of methane is about 25, and that of nitrous oxide is about 298. What this means is that 1 ton of methane has the same heating effect as 25 tons of CO2. Why 1 ton of nitrous oxide has the same heating effect as 298 tons of CO2? It is very important to understand this concept, because even as the amount of methane and nitrous oxide being released into the atmosphere is significantly lower than that of carbon dioxide, the global warming potential of these two gases are very high, and therefore the emissions must be reduced to the lowest amount possible. On a farm, greenhouse gas emissions originate mostly from soil management, which could be cropland soil or grassland soil, enteric fermentation, which is the microbial action inside the digestive system of ruminants, manure management, energy use on farm, and other sources such as burning of residues and rice cultivation. This chart shows the United States agricultural greenhouse gas sources and the percentage of greenhouse gas generated by the various sources. This can give us an idea of how greenhouse gases is generated on any farm in any part of the world. Soil management, which includes grassland soils and cropland soils, is seen to contribute about 42%, making it the largest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions on a farm. Enteric fermentation contributes 28%, energy use 15%, manure management 14%, rice cultivation and burning of residue accounts for about 1%. We must understand that there is no one magic pill to end global warming. Any such suggestion that has one messianic solution would probably be too extreme and not so effective, as it would not be embraced by the majority. So it is essential that we look at the various causes of a problem rather than at only one part, and then come up with ways in which processes can be improved to reduce the intensity and eventually eradicate the problem. Looking at the various sources of greenhouse gas emission on a farm, it would be helpful to understand how exactly these processes generate greenhouse gases. Soil acts as a carbon sink when carbon dioxide from the atmosphere is sequestered and stored in the system. This process occurs mainly through photosynthesis. During photosynthesis, plants absorb carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and the carbon is stored in the plant's foliage, seed, or root. Some of the plant's carbon would decompose and become part of the soil organic matter, which accounts for long-term storage. When forests, wetlands, or pastures are converted into cropland, a large amount of natural carbon is released into the atmosphere as carbon dioxide gas. The tillage that occurs in farming system is a major agricultural source of carbon. Tillage allows more air and microbes to gain access to the soil organic matter, and this in turn increases the rate of decomposition, thereby releasing large amounts of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere that would have otherwise remained in the soil as organic matter. After soil management at 42% of agricultural greenhouse gas emission, enteric fermentation comes next at 28%. Enteric fermentation is the natural part of the digestive process in ruminant animals such as cattle, goats, sheep, and buffalo. The microbes present in their digestive tract or in their rumen decompose and ferment food, producing methane as a byproduct. This methane is released primarily to the atmosphere through belching. The source of greenhouse gas emissions on a farm is energy use. When the electricity produced on a farm and the vehicles and other equipment are all powered by fossil fuel, this accounts for greenhouse gas emissions. Just like enteric fermentation in the digestive tract of the ruminant, a similar microbial process leads to methane production in stored manure. Whenever manure sits more than a couple of days in an anaerobic environment, that is an environment without oxygen, methane is likely to be produced. Methane can be generated in the animal housing, in the manure storage pit, and during application of manure. So this leaves us with rice cultivation and burning of residues. Rice all over the world are grown in paddy fields. These are flooded arable lands used in growing semi-aquatic rice. So in this flooded condition, the paddy soils lacks dissolved oxygen. And in the absence of oxygen, microbes that break down plant matter releases methane into the atmosphere. Agricultural residues such as palm fronds, straws, and maize stalks are produced during harvesting and processing of agricultural crops, and some farms get rid of these residues by burning. When these residues are burned, greenhouse gases are released into the atmosphere. So after looking closely into the various sources of agricultural greenhouse gases, it is clear that solutions should address how we till the soil, how we manage our manure, how we can balance the methane generated from enteric fermentation, cleaner source of energy for the farm, how we can cultivate rice better, and how to manage agricultural residues. So some studies have shown that eating less meat and dairy products and moving to a more plant-based diet will reduce the amount of methane being released by ruminant animals. This is very true, as the reduction in meat, specifically beef consumption, will reduce the market demand of beef, which in turn would reduce the amount of cows being reared, thereby reducing the amount of methane being released into the atmosphere by enteric fermentation. But let's face it, not everyone wants to go vegan or vegetarian. So how exactly can we help reduce the carbon footprint of cows while they walk the earth? First of all, I would like to suggest that there is absolutely no need to cut down trees to create grazing lands for cows. Instead, we could plant trees to house these cows. Yeah, you heard me right. I said plant trees. This technique is known as silvopasture. Silvopasture is the intentional combination of trees, forage plants, and livestock together as an integrated, intensively managed system. Silvopasture enables a farm increase its sink capabilities. Instead of forests to be cleared and converted to grazing land for cows, trees are planted together with forage crops for these cows. So when methane is released from the enteric fermentation of cows through belching, trees can absorb this methane. Yeah, I know that the common knowledge is that trees absorb carbon dioxide, which is very true. Trees absorb carbon dioxide during photosynthesis. But research has been carried out to show that some certain kinds of trees do absorb methane. According to an article released by the Nature World News, a new study by researchers in Sweden has found Christmas trees to absorb methane, the second most important greenhouse gas after carbon. By Christmas tree here, they mean spruces, pines, and firs. So by planting this kind of trees on a field and raising livestock on that field, the farm balances the methane emissions generated from enteric fermentation. The trees provide a sheltered microclimate that protects the livestock from heat and cold. This shelter also helps to improve the forage quality and lengthens the growing season. The prunings from some trees can be used as fodder, that is, as food for the animals. This results in better growing livestock. There are several advantages of this silvopasture technique that makes it really economically viable for farmers, but that will be a topic that will be discussed in another video. So now that we have looked at a technique that do not push us to deforestation, but rather afforestation by planting trees, let's look at other techniques that reduces the intensity of soil tillage. So like we've seen, frequent tilling of the soil actually leads to carbon emissions from the carbon sink in the soil. So there are some farming techniques that actually do not require you to till the soil, and I'll just name like two examples: hydroponics and aeroponics. So hydroponic is a technique that allows crop grows without soil. Instead, uses liquid, sand, gravel, and various other type of materials. The nutrients is supplied to the roots of these crops with water that is enhanced with fertilizer, which is plant food. And hydroponic is said to be able to grow twice as fast as its soil grown counterpart because they do not need to expend so much energy to develop an extensive root system. So the aeroponic system is actually a kind of hydroponic system. But while hydroponic can come in various forms, from suspending the plants in water full time, or by having a continuous flow or intermittent flow of water to actually supply nutrients to the roots of this crop, aeroponics do not immerse its roots in water at all. Instead, it gets its nutrients from a mist that is sprayed at that is sprayed with nutrients at a certain time interval. Now that we have addressed deforestation for farmland and soil tillage, then we should talk about how we can better our manure management and managing our residues and also energy on the farm. So we learned that during manure management, methane can be produced and released into the atmosphere. So I suggest that farms that have livestock that actually produce manure should develop digesters, biogas digesters to be specific. These are containers that actually help decompose organic matter in the absence of oxygen to produce biogas, which is a mixture of methane and carbon dioxide that can be used to cook generate energy. It can be used to cook, it can be used for eating, and it can actually be used to produce electricity. And also from the digester, we don't just have only biogas, but we also have organic fertilizer that comes as a byproduct. So the farm would not have to go out there to buy inorganic fertilizer, but can actually produce gas on the farm and also produce fertilizer for the crops on the farm. So when agricultural residues are produced on the farm, instead of burning it, you can actually feed these residues into your biogas digesters because it collects all organic matter. But if you do not want to do this, or if the type of digester you have is not suitable for the type of residue you are producing, you can also think of developing a compost pit. So a compost pit helps to turn this organic matter into soil, into rich soil that can be used as fertilizer also on the farm. So for energy use on the farm, I talked about biogas. Biogas can be one source of energy for your farm, but if you're not producing biogas, you can as well consider other renewable sources of energy like solar, wind, depending on the part of the world that your farm is located. So try as much as possible to reduce your energy production from fossil fuels. All these techniques that I've suggested actually makes our farm sustainable. We all know that not every farm is identical. Some farms raise livestock, some farms raise grow crops, some farms raise both livestock and crops, and there are variety of types of livestock and crops. So in order for a farmer to actually reduce the carbon footprint on his farm, he has to actually identify the sources of greenhouse gas emission on his farm and then calculate the carbon footprint. When you've gotten to this position, only then can you take actions to actually reduce your carbon footprint of your farm and reduce the greenhouse gas emissions being generated on your farm. Thank you very, very much for staying till the end of this video. I hope you learned a lot. If you want to see me discuss any sustainability topics that you're probably not clear on, or you want to hear another view on, please comment. If you have any questions, leave a comment and I'll try my best to answer. If I do not know it, I'll go search for it, I'll ask my professors and all. But let's have a discussion, let's discuss sustainability. And please, if you've not subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe. Thank you and see you in my next video. Bye.